Good evening. Thank you for coming. Welcome to Dia Readings in Contemporary Poetry. My name is Jasmine Raymond. I'm Dia's curator, and it's my pleasure to welcome you tonight to this I said to Philippe, our director, who, sorry, cannot be here tonight because he's installing the Yves Klein show at the Walker Art Center. But I was saying to him, we're restarting the fire of poetry at Dia. It's been 7 years, so we were joking about that, restarting the fire. But it's my pleasure to team up with Vincent Katz on this series and welcome you all here tonight. So I hope that you notice that we have a lineup for the rest of the season of various nights where we will be doing the readings. And I also welcome you, invite you to perhaps attend the next lecture series as well. We have Artists on Artists that happen here on Monday nights. And so those are the two public programs that we held here in Chelsea, and then we have our regular programs in Dia Beacon and at the Hispanic Society. All right, so thank you, Vincent. It's all yours.
Thank you. Good evening and welcome. I'm realizing that 6:30 may be early for poets. They seem to be waking up around now. I wrote a little something as this is the beginning after a significant hiatus. This is the very first reading in the revived Readings in Contemporary Poetry series. The series initially ran under the direction of Bridget Mullins from 1987 to 2003. And became known during that period as a series that featured celebrated poets, both innovative and academic, giving retrospective presentations of their work. Today, we are picking up where that series left off, continuing a lot of the ideas and interests of that time, and adding some new ideas. Dia's curator, Jasmiel Raymond, invited me to co-curate this series, and it has been a great pleasure to work with her. We would like to thank Barbara and Charles Wright and an anonymous donor for their generous support of this program. We'd also like to thank Christine Howe, who helped us with the coordination of this program, and Patrick Heilman for all his help in putting this series together. This series will depart somewhat from the previous model in that the readers will not be asked to present retrospectives of their work. On the contrary, they will be encouraged to do exploratory, experimental presentations, which could include music, projections, theatrical elements, anything the poet devises. It could also end up being a poet standing up and doing a reading of his or her recent work, which is also an exploratory and experimental endeavor. The other element we've decided on is to have a specific relationship between the two poets performing. Not that they necessarily already know each other, but rather that there is a generational difference. One reader who is at or near the beginning of his or her arc as a poet, paired with another who has already attained an iconic status in the world of poetry, who, in the words of the Brazilian singer and composer Caetano Veloso, already knows he is immortal. We think this intentional dynamic will result in a very special relationship between the two performances that will make them memorable for the audience and for the performers as well. It will make vivid an essential component of poetic history, the diverse expressions of lineage. Now, you are probably wondering, with Taylor Mead and John Giorno, which one is the emerging poet and which one is iconic? Well, I could make an argument that would not be entirely specious, that they are of different generations or half generations. Taylor was born in 1924 and began performing his poetry in the early 1950s, while John Giorno was born in 1936 and began publishing his poetry in the 1960s. I could make the additional argument that both these poets are both iconic, and emerging, where emerging means continually reinventing one's commitment to the art form, staying fresh and perpetually scandalous, bent on smashing the given standards of art and life. However, the fact of the matter is that we wanted to start this series off with a bang. And we wanted to present, as emblematic of this endeavor, two figures whose constant energy has been challenging and exciting audiences for decades. In particular, we wanted two people who stand for the commitment to the life of an artist, to being on the margins, always pushing the boundaries of what is acceptable, both formally and in terms of content. And we wanted to have a party. So we were delighted when both Taylor Mead and John Giorno agreed to perform in this inaugural event. John Giorno will read first, followed by Taylor Mead. There'll be a short break in between the readings. John Giorno was born in 1936 in Brooklyn and grew up in Roslyn Heights, New York. He graduated from Columbia University in 1958 and went to work as a stockbroker, which is what he was doing in 1962 when he met Andy Warhol, becoming his lover and the subject of Warhol's first film, Sleep, 1963. Influenced by Warhol's use of imagery from mass culture, Giorno developed a poetic based on seamless collage of found elements, with sources ranging from news articles of domestic tragedy, sales pitches, government propaganda, romance magazines, and hardcore porn. One of his early pieces, Pornographic Poem, from 1965, is a fantasy involving Cuban army officers that ends with the lines, "But with two big fat Cuban cocks up my ass at one time, I was in paradise." During the ensuing years, Giorno became more and more involved in Tibetan Buddhism, and elements of this entered his mix of war, sex, death, vanity, and hypocrisy. A darker tone, based on the acceptance of suffering and death, became a constant, although it was still balanced with a sense of humor. Giorno's performative bent is as palpable on the page as it is when the poems are experienced aloud, often with a visual component. There is a visual aspect to the printed poems, too, with their staggered columns of repeating phrases that vividly reference states of doubt or a lack of clarity. His shifts of tone are particularly effective. Always memorable to me is a recording by Giorno of his 1974 poem, Subduing Demons in America, which begins floating down the Green River in Utah in a kind of ecstasy and ends, quote, "Everyone is laughing at you and making fun of you, and they are drunk and stoned and nasty, and they are drunk and stoned and nasty, and you're surrounded by this terrifying freak show," etc. The records Giorno produced in the 1960s were essential conduits, allowing people to hear the actual voices and readings of beat poets, Black Mountain poets, New York School poets, John Cage, and others. One of his most innovative and influential projects was Dial-A-Poem, which Giorno produced in the 60s and 70s. He's the author of 10 books of poems, including Poems by John Giorno, Mother Press, 1964, Johnny Guitar, Angel Hair Books, 1969, Bawling Buddha, Culture Press, 1970, Cancer in My Left Ball, Something Else Press, 1973, You Got to Burn to Shine, Serpent's Tail, High Risk Books, 1994, and his selected poems, Subduing Demons in America, which was published by Soft Skull Press in 2008. William Burroughs referred to the voices as the true subjects of John Giorno's poetry. We present to you the voices of John Giorno.
Thank you. I'm going to read some poems, and I'm going to begin with a poem that's called Welcoming the Flowers. I'm standing on the corner of Stanton and Christy, waiting for the traffic light to change. A man is sitting on the steps of a building, holding his young son on his lap. He is eating fried chicken from Chico's Takeout on Houston. He chews on the wings and feeds bits of the breast to his son. The man finishes eating, puts the leftover chicken and bones, fries, and soda can in a paper bag and leaves it on the sidewalk. A brown dog from the neighboring building snoops around, gets its nose in the bag, chews on the bones, and makes a mess. The man hits the dog with a newspaper, and it yelps and runs away. A black cat sitting in a window watches wide-eyed, staring down at the dog, chicken bones, and grizzle. I see their past and present lives. The man eats the chicken, and the chicken was his mother, who had died 2 years ago of cancer. The dog chewing on the bones was his father, who had died 5 years ago of a heart attack. And the cat in the window was his grandmother. And his young son, whom he holds so tenderly, was the man who killed him in his previous life. His wife comes home with the groceries and takes the boy into the building. She had been his lover in many past lives and was his mother for the first time in this one. The world just makes me laugh. Fill what is empty, empty what is full, light as body, light as breath. Welcoming the flowers, daffodils baptized in butter, lilacs luxuriously licking the air, necklaces of wisteria bowing to magnolia mamas, the cherry blossoms are razor blades, the snow dahlias sharp as cat piss. The lilies of the valley are lilies of fur, lilies of feather, lilies of fin, lilies of skin. The almost Miss America rose. They all smell so good, and I get sucked into their meaty, earthy goodness. You make my heart feel warm. I lay my head on your chest and feel free. Filling what is empty, emptying what is full, filling what is empty, emptying what is full, filling what is empty, emptying what is full. The gods we know we are, the gods we know we were. I smell you with my eyes and see you with my ears and feel you with my lips and taste you with my nose and hear you with my tongue. I want you to sit in my heart and smile. Words come from sound. Sound comes from wisdom, and wisdom comes from emptiness. Deep relaxation in great perfection. Welcoming the flowers. Armfuls of honeysuckle and columbine, red-tipped knives of Indian paintbrush, the field of daisies are the people who betrayed me. The lupine were self-serving and unkind. Orchids are the tongues that lied. Hyacinths are the songs of suicides. The voluminous, voluptuous bougainvillea are flames licking what cannot burn. The big bunch of 1,000 red roses are all the people I made love to. Hit my nose with the stem of a rose. The poppies have pockets packed with narcotic treats. The chrysanthemums are a garland of skulls. I go to death willingly with the same comfort and bliss as when I lay my head on my lover's chest. Welcoming the flowers, the third bouquet is a crown of bluebells, a carillon of foxglove, a sunflower snuggles its head on my lap and gazes up at the sky. May all the tiny black insects crawling on the peony petals be my sons and daughters in future lives. Great balls of light, white, red, blue, concentric dazzle, yellow, green, great exaltation, the world just makes me laugh. May sound and light not rise up and appear as enemies. May I know all sound as my sound. May I know all light as my light. May I spontaneously know all phenomena as myself. May I realize original nature, not fabricated by mind, empty, naked awareness. Thank you. Next is a couple of excerpts from a long memoir piece called The Death of William Burroughs. William died on August 2nd, 1997, Saturday at 6:30 in the afternoon, from complications from a massive heart attack he'd had the day before. He was 83 years old. I was with William Burroughs when he died, and it was one of the best times I ever had with him. Doing Tibetan Nyingma Buddhist meditation practice, I absorbed his consciousness into my heart. It seemed like a bright white light, blinding but muted. I was the vehicle, his consciousness passing through me. A gentle shooting star came in my heart and up the central channel and out the top of my head to a pure field of great clarity and bliss. It was very powerful. William Burroughs resting in great equanimity and the vast empty expanse of primordial wisdom mind. I was staying in William's house, doing my meditation practices for him, trying to maintain the good conditions and dissolve any obstacles that might be arising for him at that very moment in the bardo. I had confidence that William had a high degree of realization, but he was not totally, not completely an enlightened being. Lazy, alcoholic, junkie William. I did not allow doubt to arise in my mind even for an instant, because it would have allowed doubt to arise in William's mind. Now I had to do it for him. This is a long piece, and let's skip to another part of it called What Went Into William Burroughs' Coffin with His Dead Body. On Tuesday morning, August 6th, 1997, James Grauerholz and Ira Silverberg came to William's house to pick out the clothes for the funeral director to put on William's dead body. The clothes were in a closet in my room, and we picked out the things that would go into William's coffin and grave, accompanying him on his journey in the underworld. His favorite gun, a .38 snub-nose special, fully loaded with 5 shots. The gun was my idea. William always said, you can never be too well armed in any situation. Of his more than 80 world-class guns, he often wore it on his belt during the day and slept with it, fully loaded, on his right side under the bedsheet every night for 15 years. His favorite cane, a sword cane made of hickory with a light rosewood finish. Gray fedora. He always wore a hat when he went out, and we wanted his consciousness to feel at ease dead. Blue jean, sport jacket, blue with a dark green tint. We rummaged through his closet, and it was the best of his shabby clothes and smelling sweet of him. Blue jeans, the least worn ones were the only ones clean. A red bandana, he often kept one in a back pocket. Black socks and underwear, black shoes, the ones he wore when he performed. I thought the old brown ones that he wore every day. But James Grauerholz insisted. There's an old CIA slang that says getting a new assignment is getting new shoes. Moroccan vest, green velvet with a gold brocade trim, given him by Brian Geisen 25 years before. In his lapel buttonhole, the rosette of the French government's Commandeur d'Art et Lettres, and the rosette of the American Academy of Arts and Letters, honors which William very much appreciated. A gold coin in his pants pocket, a gold 19th century Indian head $5 piece, symbolizing all wealth. He would have enough money to buy his way in the underworld. His eyeglasses in his outside jacket pocket. A ballpoint pen, the kind he always used. He was a writer and sometimes wrote longhand. A joint of really good grass. Junk. Just before the funeral, Grant Hart slipped a small white paper packet into William's pocket. Nobody's gonna bust him, said Grant. William, bejeweled with all his adornments, was traveling in the underworld. I kissed him. An early LP album of us together, 1974, was called Biting Off the Tongue of a Corpse. I kissed him on the lips, but I didn't do it, and I should have. This next poem I wrote in 1994, and it's called Just Say No to Family Values. On a day when you're walking down the street and you see a hearse with a coffin followed by a flower car and limos, you know the day is auspicious. Your plans are going to be successful. But on a day when you see a bride and groom and wedding party, watch out. Be careful. It might be a bad sign. Just say no to family values and don't quit your day job. Drugs are sacred substances, and some drugs are very sacred substances. Please praise them for somewhat liberating the mind. Tobacco is a sacred substance to some. And even though you stopped smoking, show a little respect. Alcohol is totally great. Let us celebrate the glorious qualities of booze. And I had a good time being with you. Just do it. Just do it. Just don't not do it. Do it. Christian fundamentalists and fundamentalists in general are viruses, and they're killing us, multiplying and mutating, and they're destroying us. Now, you know, you got to give strong medicine to combat a virus. Who's buying? Good acid, I'm flying, slipping and sliding, slurping and slamming, sinking and dinking and dripping inside you. Never fast forward a cum shot. Milk, milk, lemonade, round the corner where the chocolate's made. I love to see your face when you're suffering. Do it with anybody you want, whatever you want, for as long as you want, any time, any place, when it's possible. And try to be safe in a situation where you must abandon yourself beyond all concepts. Just say no to family values. We don't gotta say no to family values. We never think about them. Just do it. Just make love and compassion. Thank you. And this next poem, I started writing in July of 2001 in New York, and finished it by the end of that year here in New York of 2001. And it's called There Was a Bad Tree. There was a bad tree the people hated. The leaves gave off a foul smell, and the flowers had a bitter stink. If you got too close, you vomited. The fruit was poison. One bite and you were dead. Everyone really disliked it. The bad tree stunk. They talked endlessly about it and came to a big decision. Get rid of it. They chopped with axes and barely made a dent. Wearing breathing masks, they whacked at it and whacked at it and nibbled and chipped. Oily powder from the shiny, dark green leaves got on their skin, blistered, and was really itchy, and they scratched bloody red. They put on protective gear with oxygen and went at it with electric buzzsaws and heavy equipment, working 24-hour shifts. Finally, they cut it down. Everyone was very happy and celebrated the great victory, a noble deed, well done, and they went to bed exhausted. The next day, the bad tree had grown back, had sprung up new and bigger and more beautiful and ugly. It was very discouraging. They talked a lot about it and cut it down again and poured gasoline on the roots and burned all the leaves and branches in a big fire. After the smoldering embers got cold, the tree grew back, bigger, more bad, and really gorgeous. Other people had been watching from their houses, waiting their turn. They thought themselves smarter, with higher intellectual capabilities. They knew how to get rid of the tree. It was a growing plant, a wood tree that grew in the earth. They incinerated it, burned the roots with chemicals, vaporizing acids and robotic lasers, detonated from the ground, bombed from the air, hit with smart missiles, and bombarded with radiation. They made a firestorm and covered the ground with concrete and steel. The tree grew back, more fresh, more elegant, even gracious, and really ugly. The wood was harder, darker, thick, hot muscle, and the leaves, full and lush, moved like underwater plants luxuriously in the breeze. It was extremely discouraging, extremely depressing, a catastrophe. They had made for themselves a hell world. They talked endlessly about it and came to a big decision. The mayor resigned in disgrace, and those who had worked so hard left, humiliated, departed, moved to the other side of town, stayed away. Then, out of the blue, appeared these beautiful people. They were simple and humble, and a little like peacocks, and seemingly well-intentioned with a great sense of humor. Radiantly relaxed, oozing loving kindness and compassion, they walked right up and started eating the leaves. They ate the leaves and enjoyed them, became happy, and laughed, and chomped on more leaves. You could tell they really liked the taste. They pressed their cheeks to the flowers, black velvet coated with transmission oil. They licked the sweet juices that seeped from the petals. The pollen was coal dust and petroleum gas. Burying their noses, they sniffed in deep breaths, eating the smell. Great bliss. They discovered the fruit hidden beneath the leaves. Overripe mangoes with sticky eggplant skin hung like testicles, and inside the fruit was rotting meat like liver. The special people got their faces into the stinking slime and really got into it, inhaling with their lips and teeth and tongues. They licked and drank the thick red juice. The seeds, like cabochon rubies, seemed particularly potent and were chewed with great delight. The fruit contained the five wisdoms. The men and women became luminous. Their skin was golden, and their bodies, almost transparent, were clothed in shimmering rainbow lights. They became sleepy, yawned, and curled up under the tree and took a nap. While they slept, music filled the air. Lounging against the gnarled tree trunk and protruding roots, their huge bodies, colored red, yellow, blue, green, white, rested in great equanimity and radiated huge compassion. Inside the tree was the secret home of many demigods, hungry ghosts, and earth spirits, who were very pleased with all the positive attention being paid them. After years of abuse, mutilation, and destruction, they were thrilled, even though they were being ravaged and their flowers wrecked. At the root endings, there were jewels, diamonds and emeralds and rubies, which were stars in the sky of the world below. The beautiful men and women woke up and nibbled on the leaves again. They ate the leaves like deer, pausing between bites, looking up at the vast, empty sky. The leaves and fruit increased their clarity and bliss and introduced the nature of primordially pure wisdom mind. Thank you. Thanks. I'm going to do One more poem, and I wrote this. It's called "Thanks for Nothing," and I wrote it on my 70th birthday in December of 2006. Thanks for nothing on my 70th birthday. I want to give my thanks to everyone for everything. And as a token of my appreciation, I want to offer back to you all my good and bad habits as magnificent, priceless jewels, wish-fulfilling gems satisfying your every need and want. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thanks. May every drug I ever took come back and get you high. May every glass of wine and vodka I ever drank come back and make you feel really good, numbing your nerve ends, allowing the natural clarity of your mind to flow free. May all the suicides be songs of aspiration. Thanks that bad news is always true. May all the chocolate I've ever eaten come back rushing through your bloodstream and make you feel happy. Thanks for allowing me to be a poet, a noble effort doomed but the only choice. I want to thank you for your kindness and praise. Thanks for celebrating me. Thanks for the resounding applause. Thanks for taking everything for yourself and giving nothing back. You were always only self-serving. Thanks for exploiting my big ego and making me a star for your own benefit. Thanks that you never paid me. Thanks for all the sleaze. Thanks for being mean and rude and smiling at my face. I am happy that you robbed me. I am happy that you lied. I am happy that you helped me. Thanks. Grazie. Merci beaucoup. May you smoke a joint with William and spend some intimate time with his mind, more profound than any book he wrote. I give enormous thanks to all my lovers, beautiful men with brilliant minds, great artists, Bob, Jasper, Ugo. May they come here and make love to you. And may my many other lovers of totally great sex, countless lovers of boundless, fabulous sex, countless lovers of boundless, fabulous sex, countless lovers of boundless, fabulous sex, in the golden age of promiscuity, may they all come here and make love to you, if you want. May they hold you in their arms, bawling to your heart's delight, bawling to your heart's delight, bawling to your heart's delight. May all the people who are dead, Alan, Brian, Cookie, Jack, and I do not miss any of you. I don't miss any of them. No nostalgia. It was wonderful that we loved each other, but I do not want any of them back. Now, if any of you are attracted to any of them, may they come back from the dead and do whatever is your pleasure. May they multiply and be the slaves of whomever wants them, satisfying your every wish and desire. But you won't want them as masters, as their demons. May Andy come here, fall in love with you, and make each of you a superstar. Everyone can have Andy. Everyone can have Andy. Everyone can have Andy. Everyone can have an Andy. Huge hugs to my friends who betrayed me. Every friend became an enemy sooner or later. Deep kisses to my loves that failed. I am delighted you are vacuum cleaners, sucking everything into your dirt bag. You are none other than a reflection of my mind. Thanks for the depression problem and feeling like suicide every day of my life. And now that I'm 73 going on 74, I'm happily almost there. 20 billion years ago, in the primordial wisdom soup beyond comprehension and indescribable, something without substance moved slightly and became something imperceptible, moved again and became invisible, moved again and became a particle, and particles moved again and became a quark, and again and became quarks, moved again and became protons and neutrons and the 12 dimensions of space. Tiny fireballs of primordial energy, bits tossed back and forth in a game of catch between particles, transmitting electromagnetic light and going really fast, 40 million times a second, where the pebble hits the water. This is where the trouble began. Something without substance became something with substance. Why did this happen? Because something substanceless had a feeling of missing out on something. Not getting it. Not getting it was not getting it. Not getting it. Not getting something when there was nothing to have. From that primordially endless potential to modern day reality, 20 billion years later, has produced me, and my stupid grasp in mind has made you and me and my grasp in mind. May Rinpoche and all the great Tibetan teachers who loved me come back and love you more. May they hold you in their wisdom hearts, bathe you in all pervasive compassion, give you pith instructions, and may you, with the diligence of Olympic athletes, do meditation practice, and may you, with great confidence, realize the true nature of mind. America, thanks for the neglect. I did it without you. Let us celebrate poetic justice. You and I never were, never tried to do anything, and never succeeded. Thanks for introducing me to the face of the naked mind. Thanks for nothing.
Taylor Mead, in one of his pithy epigram-like poems, writes, "I don't need assholes to tell me who Taylor Mead is." At the risk of being called an asshole, I'm going to tell you who Taylor Mead is. Poet, performer, actor, and painter Taylor Mead was born in 1924 in Grosse Pointe, Michigan, to a well-to-do family. "My parents didn't hate me. They were just indifferent," he writes. "So I was raised by maids. You can imagine how indifferent they were." A master of timing and innuendo, Mead is able to imbue his poems with a timeless wit and the wisdom of one who has seen life from all angles. Mead is always foremost a performer, and while his poems exist with the utmost simplicity and grace on the page, much of his writing is written to be performed. One of his memorable book titles, an extremely rare book nowadays, and I saw a copy of it floating around here tonight, is 1968's Taylor Mead on Amphetamine and in Europe, published by Boss Books. Mead published Son of Andy Warhol in 1986 in the Hahnemann Books series, and most recently, A Simple Country Girl with Bowery Books in 2005. A legend in underground film and theater in both San Francisco and New York, Mead starred between 1963 and 69 in numerous Andy Warhol films, including Tarzan and Jane Regained, sort of, Taylor Mead's Ass, The Nude Restaurant, and Lonesome Cowboys. He wrote and starred in Rudy Burkhart's film Tarzan, 1969, and has appeared in films by Ron Rice, John Chamberlain, Robert Frank, Nick Zedd, Rebecca Horne, and Jim Jarmusch. He's also made a major impact in experimental theater. One of his genius performances was the lead in Frank O'Hara's The General Returns from One Place to Another, for which he won an Obie for the original production in 1964, and which has been reprised twice since then. He is the subject of William A. Kirkley's 2005 documentary, Excavating Taylor Mead. Unbelievably, and you really should go to these and support him there. He performs weekly at the Bowery Poetry Club in New York City, captivating audiences, as his press release says, with his hilarious, wry comments on sex, death, genius, and his own unique celebrity. His poetry is deceptive, faster than a drag queen's reads. Taylor Mead's one-liners have attained the classic stature of epigram. Please welcome Taylor Mead.
This getting to the mic is all part of it. Oh God, you know, with Bill Burrows and Allen and all those people, they were into chants, into I Ching, throwing the I Ching, everything. I don't need all that bullshit. let's see what we got here. I'm sort of random doing it. Oh, yes. Yeah, that's not for, it goes for $300 on BJ or JB, what? eBay. But I've been sold out for 20 years. Here's Simple Country Girl. I didn't want that title. I'm not trying to be a girl. I'm upset. In fact, I've been celibate for 31 years. Give me a break. But he, let's see, Vincent mentioned something, my well-to-do family and all that. My father was boss of Michigan for 30 years or so. And cheap as Andy. My father divorced my mother before I was born. I wasn't aborted. I am in favor of abortion. If your mother hates you, it's better not to be born. My parents didn't hate me, they were just indifferent. So I was raised by maids. You can imagine how indifferent they were, so don't be born. Oh, what am I doing here? This is sort of my favorite poem. I have no idea. Page 46. I don't know what my music is. I brought 20 tapes. So it's these chance music. There are parts of these tapes that are so perfect, but I can't organize. So I just pick out the tape that I thought I knew what it was about. Oh, God. I have no idea what this is about. This looks good. Let's see. Wrong tape. Charlie Mangus goes with everything I write, and also Emily Dickinson. I love to mix the centuries. I usually begin by reading some Emily, but I'll get to that maybe. In the meantime, I gotta turn this over. I think the other side is it. I mark it, and then I try to remember which side should be facing out. Always forget. I'm 85, fuck it.
Beethoven's Piano Concerto Number 4
with featured soloist Garrick Olson. Tonight's performance.
I have WQX on. Oh my God. I don't think the AC is working. Maybe my batteries are better. AM, FM. I hate electronics. I can't handle it. And don't get a computer. Well, you're under observation. I mean, all these great athletes go being arrested and big things made about it. Athletes used to have 27 virgins. Whatever they wanted. Now we deny them everything. And so I won't put up with it as a great athlete. Oh, God. Let's see. A function, AC, DC. I want to go back to the batteries. Maybe. Well, it's a complete fuck up.
Thank you. Looking forward to the performance.
Yeah, you bet. David, so there's Aidan Adler. She's the new executive director of this orchestra. And this is the first of five concerts that they'll will be here for at Carnegie Hall. All right. A new chapter begins for Orpheus. And, you know, it was a year and a week ago that we were here at Carnegie Hall to broadcast the Orpheus Chamber Orchestra for the very first time on listener-supported WQXR. That was we've just passed our year birthday for listener-supported WQXR. It's been an interesting past few months for...
Oh, fuck it. I don't know. That goes with a country western song that I have, but it's totally inappropriate to this fabulous thing about my mother. It's a cappella from now on, maybe. $8 million is all I need to help out my junkie friends. I want to feed bananas to all my friends' monkeys. Call the banana and order two grocery boys sent to apartment B girl at once. Gene Sieber will phone later to confirm the order. Also some breadcrumbs and a radio playing march music, covered by two blankets and some sheet music. I sat on my glasses, I can't see the. Belmondo will bring his bowl sweetbreads in a double bed. Execute that order, you motherfucker. My negligee is on fire. Smother it with semen from the USS Lexington. Get all the pumps going, including the ones with high heels. Blast off. The flame looks good. Mother ended up a drug addict in Ford Hospital, Detroit. Run over by cocaine automobiles. Zonked with x-rays. Beautiful, innocent, social conscious, slightly prejudiced, segregationist mother, a working Mary Astor of the wealthy suburbs, and mother of two sons, one son being half moon, namely me. Shine on, harvest me. She liked to eat sodas at Schraff's, or Saunders, which is the Detroit Schraff's. I remember her very well, though I just saw her en passant. In passing. Radio.
Schubert, the son of a school teacher.
And as a child, he had the nickname Schwammerl, which would translate to tubby. And maybe that cruel nickname
had some influence in his title of the symphony, which is the Tragic Symphony. A tragic symphony written by a teenager. Tenants, the folks are coming out.
I'm going to do a fairy tale. It's at the Whitney Museum at the moment, or was at the Biennale or something. All right, a fairy tale by Taylor Mead. Oh my God, there's such good music to go with this. Somewhere in that pile. Let me try again. A fairy tale by Taylor Mead. Whitney wanted to think that I Xeroxed some of it, and they said, Taylor, we've got to have the originals. So I kept making copies, and I don't know which is which. But anyway, it's a fairy tale. Well, here's the way I file my stuff in my. I kept doing different versions. Once upon a time, there's a pun, the guy sitting on a clock. Another guy, another Xerox. In a large castle, and this is the for poor cousins. I know that feeling. In fact, mention the Walker Art Center, that's my great uncle. But I've never been to Minneapolis, but they do send me out once in a while. A large castle, guest house. A monster dwelt.
Do you wanna go out?
A monster.
You smile.
forest nearby, Andy Warhol was terrorizing the local inhabitants. No, it says a handsome prince. By the way, John, I turned Andy down. Wasn't my time. The monster went out on his... I tried to draw a horse that came out of a camel or whatever. It's more abstract. More. It's, now it turned out a fox. I can't. I used to draw horses, but fuck it. They fought like hell. Oh no, where's the hell music? I don't even know your name, but they fought like hell. This is war. I don't know why I put this in. It's war is just masturbation. Oh my God, I thought I had it organized. They both lost. They lost. They lost. Bunch of losers. Ah, they both lost. Zero. Castle for rent. A guest house for rent. Princess for rent. Princess for rent. Princess. Credits. Castle, prince, monster, horse, fighter, best boy. This is more credits than, oh, there she is. Yeah. Oh, that's the radio. Oh. I should have kept the AC on. Battery. Don't get Duracell batteries. This is anti-advertising. I wish my Vicodin would kick in. Whatever. Ah. I guess I should throw the I Ching or something. Oh, I know. I'll read from, this is my Bible. This I wrote. They're all dead. So many of my friends are dead. This is Dia Foundation and my friend Dash Snow, part of the Domenico family, who I've known since Paris in the 60s. A great family. I wanted their shelter, right? They're all dead, Dash. Every one of them, Mrs. Ziegler, Auntie Grace, all dead as doornails. Denver Williams, his mother and father, and old Mrs. Denver, daughter of the general after which Denver, Colorado is named. All dead. My mother, my crazy Aunt Dorothy. Doornails, everyone. I love them in my fashion, in their fashion. Passionately love them. Now a whole raft of gossamer cowboys streaming out there, blowing faint impressions back, but vast, sad, still alive, no one ever really dies. Mixed ethereally, yes, dead as doornails, melting, sinking, mixing. It's a grand day, and my grandmother and grandfather and Grand Illusion and Grand, I gotta clean my glasses. Oh, I forgot my bounty towel. I forgot everything. Only get bounty. The other stuff is no good. It's raspy and evil. Brawny and all that shit. Oh, wonderful. It's a grand day, and my grandmother and grandfather and Grand Illusion and Grand Duchess and Grand Duke and Grand Canyon and Grandiose and granulated and graduated and granted and grabbed and groped and grammared and grown and groaned and guts and shit and God and whoopee, it's fucking October. I had a different month, whatever month, I'm so old, Carol. Where do you buy love? Give me the address quick. I'll get the money somehow. I'll write home for extra money to buy love. I'll say I'm in trouble and need $100. But even then, they might not send it. God, I'll have to work to make money to buy love. To hell with it. I think I've used up this book. How much is Social Security? Does it include fringe curtains on cubicles in Turkish baths or skin-tight plate glass, sailors, uniforms, or tiny dicks for the Marines at Camp Pendleton Pendulous in California where I went once? J. Edgar Hoover, I don't like him. Oh, wait, I must have more. Oh, my God. Ah. Oh, I'll read an Emily Dickinson short poem, but she needs a Charlie Mingus, and I have no idea what the bitch is writing about either. But when I read it to an audience, I begin to understand it. Let's see if Beethoven is still on. Oh my God. I've had this 30 years, I can't master it. But it's better than having a computer. Because I might check in on child porn, you know. I'm curious about everything. And I came out when I was 12, you know, captain of the football teams. Oh no, that was later. Most handsome boy in school. And we were watching, I forget what movie we were watching. He put his hand in my crotch. And I immediately knew I knew everything, immediately. So anyway. Here Emily says, down in the house, doom. God, doom is the house without the door. 'Tis entered from the sun, and then the ladder's thrown away because escape is done. 'Tis varied by the dream of what they do outside, where squirrels play and berries die, and hemlocks bow to God. Well, I like that one. Let's go with it. Should I do my dirty poem? Because I'm a mess here. And my Vicodin is delayed. Emily Dickinson. One hour. Wong Chu pose. There's no doubt about it. Traditional something or other coming your way. Traditional weather coming your way. It's going to be hot this August day. So put on your clothes, now take off your clothes. Just wear some ribbons and three or four bows and come down to eat at Wong Chu Po's. Your mother's a saint, your father's a thief, your daughter's a whore, and we serve nice bread beef. So string up a loop and put in your head, we serve perfectly good whole wheat bread. The windows are clean, the tablecloth is sublime. Our vegetables and rice are cooked in steam. The desserts are cold and runny and thick. Get under the table and wipe them on your prick. Eat, eat, eat at Wong Chu Po's. I ate at a great restaurant last night. It's Josephine Baker. Josephine is Shea Josephine. Very good. They need the business. Here. Now this goes with who's this? This goes with Slim Gaylord. This is my country western. Country western is so easy. controversy. How is this for timing? Here we go. Slim Gaillard. Country Western. Highway through my living room. My dog died. An atom bomb destroyed our Big Ben, and my girlfriend's allergic to carrots, and the highway goes right through our house. Mother's catatonic and dad is gone. My sister has lupus. The Lord is not watching over us, and Madonna's wearing my pet possum. And Aunt Sadie is president of the United States. Otherwise, things are okay.
Humpty had a great fall.
He did. Humpty Dumpty slid off the wall.
Thank you, Lord, wherever the hell you are. I did vote for Ralph Nader. I hope I'm... Does that date me? I hope I'm not a loser in the sweet by and by.
Dumpty, Dumpty. Ooh, Dumpty had a terrible fall. Humpty, Dumpty, Dumpty. Humpty, Dumpty, Dumpty.
I'll read somebody else's fucking material. This is by David Burgess. Must be British. It's called My Goldfish Died. Little Nancy was in the garden. Oh, this is good.
Humpty, Dumpty, Dumpty. Look out, Dumpty. You had a great fall. Humpty fell again.
Little Nancy was in the garden filling in a hole.
Look out now. We're ready to jump before the river.
When her neighbor peered over the fence, interested in what the cheeky-faced youngster was up to, he politely asked, "What are you doing there? What are you doing there, Nancy?" "My goldfish died," replied Nancy tearfully, without looking up. "And I've just buried him." The neighbor was very concerned. "That's an awfully big hole for a goldfish, isn't it?" Nancy patted down the last heap of dirt, then replied, "That's because he's inside your fucking cat." Is that a haiku? I don't know. Oh my God. "I'm born again. It's me and Jimmy Carter, me and Stevie Wonder, me and Bob Dylan, me and Roger Guinness, we got born again. Play that on your harp. Up in the morning, down on my knees. Please say God bless you if I happen to sneeze, because I'm born again. Praise Jesus, wherever. You too can get born again. Just send $40 to Taylor Mead, box 00000, Holy Rood Station, Chicken Shit, Iowa, or Kansas, or wherever. If you send in an extra $3, we'll send you a special button, $4 St. Jude or something. $25, Jesus. Now let's see, I'm trying to close. I think everybody's gay, even the sun goes down. God, that's page of my 2,000 pages, that's page 6. That must be 1960 or 59. That big jailer in the sky. A bigger sin than not being a star is having bad breath or popping and snapping your gum. Everybody's got their black umbrellas and their turtle soup. I had the greatest squash soup last night at Shea Josephine. I saw Josephine Baker, one of the greatest, the Marlon Brando in a streetcar and Josephine Baker at the Capitol Theater 60 years ago. And anyway, fantastic. You better watch out. Santa Claus is coming to town and he's got a goat with him. Death is not, oh, this is terrible. And it's John Lennon. I made a movie with John Lennon and Yoko Ono called Up Your Legs Forever. And I thought, Up Your Legs Forever, that means nudity. So I came out of the dressing room totally nude. And John and Yoko, this is before they did their nude stuff, all giggled sort of. And it just meant up your knees. Oh, I turned them on to nudity, maybe. Death, did I read death is not that big a deal? Death is not that big a deal. John Lennon was not Jesus Christ, and neither was Jesus Christ. Oh my God, this is a different audience. Now, this is for John Giorno. I think one should be fucked every night. A poem. Okay, I'll try to read. This I wrote 30, 40 years ago. And it must be good because Allen Ginsberg plagiarized it. Almost word for word. But in the 60s, I think a lot of poets plagiarized everything they read, or they just changed a few words. Now this, this country western is totally inappropriate. So I'll play it.
Rhythm is jumping, jump session. Rhythm is jumping, jump session.
WQXR. I want to lick his asshole. Suck his nipples, around his nipples, under his arms, down his middle, around his stomach, his belly button, the hair below it, to the great thing between his legs, on top of it. This music is so... WQXR. They play war horses all the time. I'm gone. Oh, now I've completely ruined it. Oh, we gotta go back to the war horse. Oh no. I want to lick his asshole. Did I say that already? suck his nipples, around his nipples, under his arms, down his middle, around his stomach, his belly button, the hair below it, to the great thing between his legs. Oh, that's so inappropriate. Between his legs, on top of it, soft around down, a chasm between the mountain's point flesh, round, deep into my throat, slowly, too far away. I can't breathe. Take it, bitch. Swallow. Roll over on my stomach. The great thing dribbles down my back, gradually finds my buttocks and into them, plunges slippery, slipping, gradually, artistically, lubricatingly, ecstatically, slowly plunges into my hot, hollow lips.
Swing it round and down. Mama, look up there. I beat it out. Look it all the time. I look up there. Swing.
Pretend it's Charlie Mingus. His tongue licks thickly my nape of neck and hair. A charge suffuses me.
You're always mine. You told me we were through.
I think QXR is better. I can't breathe. Take it, bitch. Swallow. Roll over on my stomach. The great thing dribbles down my back, gradually into my buttocks, into them, and plunges slippery, slipping, gradually, artistically, lubricatingly, ecstatically. Slowly plunges into my hot, whole lips. His hands surround my breast, his lips my nape. His tongue licks thickly my nape of neck and hair. A charge suffuses me. A charge me. A charge suffuses me. Ah, where am I? Throbbing, he grips tighter, warmer. His arm muscle flex out against the pressure he puts on me. He throbs into me. His buttocks work. Where am I? he throbs into me for a time. His arms slip down around my middle, his buttocks working greatly. His hands on my cock and balls and up all over. And squeeze my stomach, my sides. Help the neighbors. Oh, but that's not in the poem. I fuck up my own poems. Still he goes, rolling around down away. We tie forever each other, oozingly, graciously, fleshly, to eternity.
With me is Terrence McKnight, who's backstage with all the musicians as they come off the stage to the applause of the audience.
Charlie Mingus is the only one that I can cope with. I'll close with the only poem I remember. At 40 years or 50, I remember you. Oh, Christ. I'm going to try one more anonymous tape here. This is it.
Oh, definitely from the audience as definitely, well. Definitely, definitely. And I spoke with a number of our patrons before the concert, and I know they're just as excited for the opening night of the orchestra.
Yeah, so what's it like playing without a conductor?
It's engaging and exciting. This frenetic energy I mentioned, that's good in that anything can happen at any point. And we really take chances when we play collectively together. That's one thing I really enjoy in this kind of shared collaborative model that we use.
A cappella! Thelonious Monk would even help, you know. I can't get it up. It's only 30 years old, this machine. From Radio Shack. Don't buy anything at Radio Shack. That's an anti-commercial.
musicians of Orpheus have to work together to craft their performances, and it does bring a special energy to the project, I think, coming from the stage and going toward it.
Be happy. Don't worry, be happy now. Don't worry.
I remember you raped me one night.
Be happy.
When I was coming home alone, you sneaked up near me and put your arms around me. And squeezed. And threw me on the grass, tearing deliciously on the wet grass and inundating my loins at midnight near Brooklyn.
Somebody came and took your bed, don't worry. Be happy.
Squeezed, threw me on the grass, stripping my clothes and tearing deliciously on the wet grass, inundating my loins at midnight near Brooklyn. In a deserted section of desperation, and I rolled over to receive all of you that night.
Look at me, I'm happy.
You were strong, oh so strong. So, such a rapist. Round about midnight. And you took me. Oh, where are you? I've been celibate 31 years. Where are you?
Ain't got no cash, ain't got no style, ain't got no girl to make you smile, but don't worry.
Your strong face breathing heavily against mine, your silent rape will remind me indefinitely, baby.
That will bring everybody down, so don't worry.
Thank you.